night falls, when the shadows become deep and black, the silent pall of evil settles on the earth. Who dares to search? Who dares to see what walks in the night? If you dare, welcome to Nightmare.
Spot, my friends. One place upon the earth where you are surrounded by the mementos, the souvenirs, the things that remind you of the high points in your life. Such a place is dear to one, is it not? This room is such a place to me. For this is my trophy room. This is the place I like to be the most. But you have never been here before, have you? And have never completely toured my collection. How thoughtless of you. Come, my friends, and allow me to show you around.
Why, thank you, Oscar, the magic trash goblin. Just woke up, sorry. It's the great Grotu Orloff television program. And we're up here in the Grotu Orloff International Building of Trade, floor 7. This is room 2. We haven't been in here that often. This I call the theater room. But this is going to be a special episode. We're going to be looking at some records. Or as the young whippersnappers call them, vinyls. Don't call them vinyls. If you want to call them vinyl records, that's okay. But vinyls, no. So, So, tomorrow my friends are down over in Alabama are going to tour that movie theater that's for sale. My wife's kind of pretty much already saying she doesn't want to do it, but we'll have to see how, just what it looks like in that upstairs area, then that decision will be made. But no decision's been made. Right now, I've started to contemplate a major move within the Grotu Orloff building. I was thinking of moving just about every bookshelf on floor 7 down to floor 6, where the master bedroom is, and turn it into a library, where all the bookshelves are in there, or most of them. And then I even have these big giant signs from an old library, an old school library, that showed different categories of books and everything from the 50s, and I'd like to put up. So we could have a library. And then the master bedroom would come up and be in that room where we've been the last few weeks, a small room. And the idea is that if there was a horrible invasion of the Grotu Orloff building and the bad guys were coming up the stairs, we'd be in the upstairs part and we'd have more time to eradicate the invading enemy. That's my wife's idea. but it's a good one, yeah. Plus, anyone coming in, I mean, imagine someone, can you imagine someone coming into our inner sanctums and, you know, someone looking to steal things to get money and seeing books? You know, books are like the worst thing in the world to an idiot, to a scumbag, to a Hunter Biden drug type. I mean, books are books. I took all the time to break into this building or this house, and there's books. Books are for squares. Where's the jewelry? Anyway, so let's look at some records, shall we? Anyway, so I may do some episodes soon where I'm moving massive wooden bookshelves around in books, and that should be something for you to tune in and laugh at. But I gotta do something. What do we got here? I have to clear off some stuff on top of the records before I can get to the records. There's some Barbie catalog. The new era for Barbie. I think I saved it because of this cool Wonder Woman Barbie. Look at that. So this goes in the pile of things to save, like everything else that I'm encountering. What is this? Oh, for the longest time, I had at Best Buy, they gave me like a subscription for $1.50 to Entertainment Weekly, and I've got 50 million copies of this shit. Well, it's actually not that bad compared to most magazines. I don't even know if they still publish it. I haven't seen it in forever. Maybe they, like all magazines, they stopped publishing it. But anyway, I got too many of them. I don't know where to put them all. And this one, you know, has got Wolverine on it, so I'll put them in a pile of Entertainment Weekly, and that'll be put in a box somewhere. And, oh, this is great. I gotta save this. This is a student of mine that was obsessed with Spy versus Spy. He had Asperger's, which I'm pretty sure I have. I'm pretty sure just about anyone that collects comic books has Asperger's, but now they say Asperger's don't even exist. Yeah, but anyway, he was completely obsessed with Spy versus Spy. Isn't that amazing? A kid today in 7th grade obsessed with Spy versus Spy. Here are the directions for a fan I have downstairs. I guess I'll save that in some, put that in some cigar box or something. What is this stuff? Here's another cool fan we've got. All right. Here's a, I must have copied this. It's an ad for a Twist and Turn Barbie. I guess that'll be saved. Okay, that stuff needs to be saved. Look at this. Photo scrapbook. This is where a young teenage girl in the 1950s might, that's hip and stylish, would keep their photos. And there's no photos in it. Or perhaps I could put some in there. So, yeah, 1950s photo scrapbook. Goes there. All right, this is not in very good condition, but this is a book that reprints Tijuana Bibles. They call them Tijuana Bibles. They also call them eight pagers, because back in the 30s and 40s when these were made, people thought they were being printed in Mexico, but they were pornographic comic books that came out in the 30s, and I don't know how they were sold. They had the current stars in comic strips, Flash Gordon, Popeye, Superman, but they were incredibly dirty. And a nostalgic romp through history when the eight-pager was the in thing, and the comic strip heroes were unclothed, unabashed, unrestrained, undignified, and uninhibited for entertainment of adults only. Let me see when this was printed.
We're talking about a country slicker. Yeah.
They have a little.
Seems as though all small towns have one.
Oh man, they don't even have they don't have anything in here that tells where or when this was printed, because they probably didn't want to be traced. All we know is that it's printed in USA. There's no inside page, just there's nothing. Yeah, I mean, see, comic strip tease. And then look, you don't believe me? Usually they have all the printing information first, but nothing. See if I can show you an example. There's got to be some pages in here that are I could show. Like here's an example. Yeah, Snuffy Smith. Here's Popeye and Steppin' Out. They were basically like those little Jack Chick religious tracks. They were about that size, but they were 8 pages long. Hold on. I probably shouldn't be showing these offensive stuff, but it's Papa. Anyway, so I have this book. Let's put that up here. Here's Moby Dick in The Adventures of Ulysses. And Mickey Spillane. Me Hood. 2 copies. Mickey Spillane. Great writer. You know, he actually wrote for Marvel Comics. He text features in the old Atlas 1950s comics. Here's some Spanish language Mexican comics. You know, it's like nothing great. Cover, it's just like a pirate romance story. The cover promises far more supernatural material. It's El Umbral de Ultra Tumba, Suspenso y Terror, a todo color. I guess that means all color. Oh yeah, it does have a little bit of there's some. This kind of stuff. Shocking. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't go that far, but, you know, but it's kind of, it doesn't go real far like those 1930s comics. It's more like, doesn't even go as far as creepy and eerie. The hairs scares everything. Here's another copy of this. No, this is El Libro Vaquero. I don't know what that means. The cowboy book, something like that. Nothing exciting in this one. That must mean the passion book, El Libro Pasional. There's Cuerpos y Almas. I don't know what that means. Hombres y Hero. They used to sell these in a Mexican supermarket near me. Or I may have gotten these. I don't know where I got them. Yeah, this one's just cheap ass black and white. No me maltrates. Yeah, it's not good quality or anything. This is El Mensajero El Diablo. So this is a devil comic. El Libro Policio, whatever. This one's color. But yeah, don't expect anything great. Nothing amazing. Okay. Why, it's the Arrow Book of Science Riddles. That music might be too loud. What do you think? Let's, blah, blah. I have the volume adjusted just right over in room 3, but Let's take a look at what wonderful things we've got here in these boxes of records. We went through some records a few months ago. Well, that was just about 2 months exactly if you go back in the archives. I remember I was showing you records, and then later that day the electricity went off and it was freezing cold outside, and in the snow that was so beautiful, it started to be awful because it was 0 degrees outside, and we almost froze to death in our own home. That was a lot of fun 2 months ago. Now it's real nice outside. So what will be the next way that they try to take us out? I hear that old Billy Boy G, you know, what they have, the opening defenses, call it G, ends with that Billy, the, you know, Billy, the computer guy. I hear he wants to shoot a bunch of particles up into the stratosphere to dim the sun. I forget what he wants to send up there. Because help with the, you know, the global warming. Okay, yeah. That guy, I tell you, is like literally out of like a villain out of a James Bond novel. Actually, George Soros is probably more of that. No, they're about equal. But, you know, he wears all these pink shirts and everything, sweaters, so you think he's just this innocent, nice guy. Okay, what do we got here? It looks like some 1980s, really terrible art on the cover. I hate this kind of shitty art. But it's a Jerry Lee Lewis 18-track album. No, 16-track. Okay. Remember Captain Cool and the Kongs? Boy, that light's annoying. Wonder if I could adjust that light. Captain Cool and the Kongs were from Saturday morning television. Sid and Marty Croft. And you can bet you think, well, how did anyone ever buy that record? Well, no one did. This is a demonstration record, not for sale. They sent the DJs to try to convince them to play it. And I probably bought it for a quarter or a dollar. But, you know, it's Captain Cool and the Kongs. Remember that record ad? In the 70s, they were trying to sell a Smokey Robinson and the Miracles record. It was like a KTEL kind of, you know, greatest hits of Smokey Robinson and the Miracles. And they show some disapproving ad in the 60s. You know, oh, you're always playing that damn music. And the kid goes, but Dad, it's Smokey. What I was thinking. But guys, it's Captain Cool and the Kongs, Dad. They're the coolest. Herman's Hermits, 15 greatest hits. Oh, that damn light is still annoying. Perhaps that light should be farther away. Let's try that experiment. Let's try it. I got the light extension cord. Well, anyway, it's a beautiful Sunday morning here in Gratuitville, and last night I watched the Captain America Sidekick Hour, and I won't ruin it for all of you that haven't seen it yet, but whenever they did all this U.S. agent stuff in the comics, I guess that was the 90s. I don't really know exactly what how that storyline worked, or if U.S. agent is currently a hero or a villain in the comic book continuity. But oh well. You haven't seen it yet, probably, so I won't talk about it. Okay, maybe we put this freaking light way over here. Oh, shit, I'm tripping myself. This room is Okay. Now with the light over there, it's not all up in my grill. My grill, indeed. Don't you hate people that say grill? Okay. We haven't gone to this record box. See, it's right from the sound warehouse. Remember them? Okay, light's not as bright. Let's see if it... I like that reflection of the ring and the... Oh, that's better. Sam Cooke Live at the Harlem Square Club, 1963. I was watching this morning, Kayfabe Comics. I guess it's Kayfabe Comics. You should subscribe to them. They normally deal with kind of independent, underground kind of titles, but this morning they were talking about the Galactus Trilogy, which is how I became a comic book person. I mean, superhero comic book person. And it was Marvel Treasury Edition number 2, which is right over here. I got that in probably the end of third grade. And before then, I was just buying all the monster comics. You know, Chamber of Chills, House of Mystery, Ghost, and Dennis the Menace, Tomb of Dracula, Werewolf by Night. But anyway, I get this giant tabloid-sized comic of the Fantastic Four, and it has reprinted in it the Galactus Trilogy. And it just blew my mind. And then after that, I sought out Fantastic Four comics and the Spider-Man comic I already owned, that I'd never read, that was bought for me by my mother. I went and read that, and I started buying that, and it completely got me into the superhero stuff. And it's just the most amazing thing to read when you're a third grader. It blows your mind. It's so great. And they were showing the Marvel Treasury Edition, and you know, they had, you know, the deal where the comics are laid out, and then there's a camera up above looking down at them. And he says, well, here's even better. And then the guest on the show brought out 3 copies, really good condition, of the original trilogy. And they went through it page by page and talked about it. That's my kind of entertainment for a Sunday morning. Damn. I love that. But that's what did it. Can you imagine? Just can't even imagine how great that was. This is James Brown's greatest hits, but I don't know how you have his greatest hits just on one record. That's kind of hard. Okay, here we're getting into the good stuff. Harry Brewer and his quintet, Mallet Mischief. I bet this is available on YouTube. I haven't looked, but it's a great record. The kind of music you hear in the background of Gratu's show, some people call it bachelor pad music, or it was designed to show off your brand new hi-fi set, and you had speakers, and they call it bachelor pad music. You bring over a date, and hey, listen to this record, and they'd be amazed. The sounds coming out of different speakers, And then you'd, you know, have your bar and everything, and just amaze, knock out this girl with how cool and urbane you are. Yeah. Here's the Bonzo Dog Band with their album Gorilla. This is something you need to investigate. Look up the Bonzo Dog Band, also called the Bonzo Dog Dubit. Anyway, Bonzo Dog Band. If you're into Monty Python and 60s music, and yeah, this is all in there. It's good. Okay. Here's Bong Water, The Power of Pussy. And there she is, all Raquel Welched out. You know, the amazing thing about YouTube is I bet all these records I'm showing you, you can just listen to them. You don't have to go out to the record store. You know, if this was a public access show and it was the 1990s or 80s and someone was showing you their records, it might take you decades to go out and find all these records. And now the one cool thing about YouTube is just go on and you can just type in and you could find any of this. Blue Cheer, Louder Than God. This is the Rhino. Blue Cheer was famous for they did a cover of Eddie Cochran's Summertime Blues, but they were famous for how wild they played. That would just blow out your eardrums. And Blue Cheer, along with The Who, were famous for that. And then in the 80s, there was a girl band called the Pandoras that did 60s style garage rock. And they were real loud too, where they were fucking up people's hearing. And Angry Samoans. Now, there's two types of people. There are punk rockers that know this image from the Angry Samoans record, and there's people that know it from the Monster of Piedras Blancas, which I first saw this image in the Monster Times as a kid, and it blew my mind. Like, the Galactus trilogy blew my mind. This image blew my mind. And you just can't even imagine. It's like a Creature from the Black Lagoon ripoff, and he's holding a human head, and you can't even imagine how horrifying that movie must be, and how gory and bloody. You just, it's like, it looks, the image, it looks like you're looking at a car wreck. It looks completely real. And of course, in the movie, that's the thing, those monster magazines in the 60s made those movies from the 50s look horrifying. And then when you really see them, it's like, boy, taking that picture out of context sure does make the movie seem far scarier. Here's Ebb Tide by Earl Grant. Price tags are scary to remove. Sometimes it pulls the art right. There's a way to do it with lighter fluid or something. I'm not real, I'm a little scared, you know. I still haven't done any. You guys are all experts pressing your comics and everything. I have not pulled the trigger on all that. These are things I must have gotten at a half-price book sale. It's the Sleepwalk Guitars of Dan and Dale. They did a Batman record, Dan and Dale. I gotta go downstairs and make sure that my recording is still going. Golden Organ favorites. Lenny D. He was famous. The Groovin' Strings and Things. Ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. The Groovin' Strings and Things is an exciting introduction to a completely new contemporary sounds, the meeting of hard rock and soft strings. It's a colorful, breezy combination of violins, woodwinds, flutes, etc. And a with it right now rhythm section. Lush foreground, swinging background for dancing, partying, and the grooviest leisure time listening. Conceived by Cub Records' latest manager, Irv Stemmler, and A&R producers, Beau Ray Fleming, and Lockie Edwards Jr., the Groovin' Strings and Things presents a sparkling variety of modern moods and bags. From the hard funk rendition of You, Marvin Gaye's hit brilliantly performed here by Jerome Richardson, to the hauntingly beautiful Beatles tune, Fool on the Hill, featuring leader of a you can read the rest if you buy this record. Here's the history of surf music from Rhino Records. I don't like that kind of art. It's kind of like art from the side of a van, I guess was the intention, but not my bag. It's not my bag, man. Here's the Soul of Spain. It's 101 strings. This 101 string, I mean, every estate sale you go to, you're going to find 101 strings. And Mantovani. I still contend that Mantovani must have sold more records than the Beatles, because every estate sale you go to, every garage sale, it's like all you find so many Mantovani records. My dad, when he bought his stereo, which he had so many Mantovani records, I was just, come on, why couldn't he have bought some good stuff? Like my older brothers, they were born in the 50s, right? Early to mid-50s, and I was born in the mid-60s. So they were the right age. They could have been buying the Galactus trilogy right off the spinner rack at 7-Eleven in 1966. Why didn't they? They never bought that. They didn't like Marvel. So they were probably buying well, that what they were buying wasn't bad. I'm sure they were buying DC War Comics and, you know, Sergeant Rock and the Haunted Tank and Superman and stuff, but Justice League. But if right next to those comics, you could have plucked Jack Kirby at his very best. You know, I just wish they had. But of course, none of those comics ever were handed down to me. They were gone before I came around, so if they had bought those, it would have just been more aggravating. Okay, so I'm recording down here. But as I've told you before, if you don't play around with YouTube, they will stop. So this is an Etta James song. See, hold on, I'll show you what I'm doing. There's a playlist on YouTube. Damn it. Okay. So, I record from YouTube using a DVD recorder, which they don't sell anymore. But the DVD recorder, you can put it in the 6-hour speed. It does not reduce the sound quality. Well, what you got, this is a playlist with 2,695 songs. And it's Hammond Mod Jazz, 60s beat, rhythm and blues, and funky groove. And so I'm up I'm about maybe 1,300 songs into this 2,695 song list. So I record in 6 hours. So getting 6 hours, that you can get a good probably, I don't know, maybe 600-800 songs on the disc, which is what I do. And it provides music for the background of the Gratu Orloff show and stuff. But what'll happen is, they want to, their advertisers on YouTube want to know that people are actually viewing. So maybe if I paid a few extra bucks and got the YouTube Deluxe, I wouldn't do this. But this new thing they started a few years ago, if you just leave it playing for an hour, about right around an hour and 4 minutes, it will stop and say, "Are you still watching? Press yes to continue." And then if you're not, if you just leave the house and let it record, you're going to record all this silence. So what I do is I have to fiddle around with it and press a button on the Roku remote, and that should start the timer over at an hour, so I can go back upstairs and check more records. And yeah. And this is a picture of Ming the Merciless by Don Marquez, who sells a lot of paintings on eBay. He's kind of a Frazetta imitator. Captain Strangelife was mentioning that he saw this painting, but yeah, I love Charles Middleton, and I've got these great pictures, paintings here. These aren't relatives. I got them in an antique store, but I just thought they were great. And here, let me try to get some more light on them. And so I adopted them. And they were selling them, both of these, for like $30, and I just thought, well, I'll adopt them as relatives, just like this picture I saw for $30 at a store that sold old bathtubs and old antique doors and stuff for if you're restoring a house. And I thought, this picture is so haunting and so beautiful, I guess, of two sisters. I mean, look at this. And I thought, you know, she told me how much it was, and then I didn't get it. And then I went back the next day, and I had to get this picture. So now, whoever got rid of this picture, now they're my relatives, you know. Oh, and let me show you, this is cool. This is my wife when she was a little girl, so I got real relatives. And and then I got the Panther girl, and then over there, if you can see it, I've got my grandfather, who's a professional baseball player. And look at this sign here. That was painted by Lance Laurie. You can get art from him on eBay. I bought several paintings from him. He paints them on boards, and that's hanging on the door to the master bedroom. It's closed because my wife's still sleeping. She didn't get to sleep till real late. So, here's my dog, Drusilla, sleeping. She's real beat. Let's go back upstairs. Yeah, that's my grandfather, baseball player. I love this picture here. Frankenstein surrounded by adoring fans. Okay. I gotta change this light bulb. Gotta do that. All the things I gotta do. It's a horrible life being Gratu. Okay, so we're back. Now I don't have to worry about recording silence on my disc downstairs. Beach Boys, Sunshine Dream. Nothing real, just a 70s reissue, you know, greatest hits kind of deal. Got a bunch of these greatest hits records that are probably worthless. Coaster's greatest hits. I mean, great music, but it's, you know, reissues. Joe Cocker's greatest hits. You know, I never pretended this is exclusively a comic book channel. I talk about comic books, but this is a pop culture channel. And, but that's, you know. So hopefully everyone's cool with looking at records, too. Another Sam Cooke record. Beautiful voice. Unbelievable. What is this? For All Mankind. Oh, this is a laser disc. About the moon landing. I'm sorry, there'll be better records. Every band has a Shonen Knife who loves them. Shonen Knife is a Japanese girl band. And the thing about them is I think Kurt Cobain talked about how much he loved Shonen Knife, and that caused them to kind of explode in popularity during the 90s. I think I'm correct on that. And other bands like Red Cross, that's a great band. In fact, Red Cross, they even do a song called Red Cross. So it's kind of mutual love there. Ronnie Self, great rockabilly guy, great. That's one reason I'd like to buy that theater, is to have bands play and stuff. But if that upstairs living area had just been in better shape, we'll see tomorrow. I'll see, and what I'll do is I'll show you the video when it comes in from our friends. I'll put it on my wife's tablet. I'll hold it up to this, do it old school, whatever. Here's the Slicky Boys. This is an 80s band. But, you know, using old art, really good art. Yeah. The Slicky Boys. And this looks like a 60s record, but it's contemporary. It's from the 80s, The Sick Rose. I think they were out of Italy. But in the 80s, there was a revival of 60s garage rock kind of music, and people tried to be like 60s bands and record and sound, have the same sound. And the Sick Rose, either out of Italy or Spain, I can't remember. What is this? Oh, this is the Spinal Tap Black Album. You know, this is basically the soundtrack of the movie. And then, of course, they show their previous albums, which never existed because it was a fake band like the Ruddles. Oh, I remember trading this in high school. It's the Standells, but they're not doing their own music. They're covering someone must have, some DJ or something. Don't play this record. That's what that means. But these are all cover versions of songs that were popular right about 1966. the Galactus trilogy time. See, I keep throwing in comic references, and it will fool you into staying with this channel. Folk rock hits. The big sound of Billy Strange in his guitar. There's a whole world of collecting records with pinups. There's a local record store, couple of record stores near me. One is called Forever Young, but they're way expensive. And the other one is Doc's Records. And Doc's Records, and I think Forever Young, they have special sections just for these, for records with girly kind of covers. Okay, Spend the Night with the Trash Women. This is an example of a modern band that has an old sound. Of course, the Trash Men was a 60s band that did Surfin' Bird and a lot of other great surf music. It was not, they had a lot of great songs. You gotta like get music by the Trash Men. But they're a girl band that is kind of like the girl version of the Trash Men. Oh, here's the actual Trash Man, Bird Dance beat. You know, what the Trash Men did is they took, there was a band from the 50s called the Rivingtons, and they took Papa Umau Mau and the Bird's the Word, and they kind of mushed them together into a surf song, and it became Surfin' Bird. And that was, what, around 63? The Three Sons are great. I mean, maybe not all their albums, but usually they, maybe all their albums, they're just great. They, their music's fantastic. Especially if it's in stereo, it's just insane, the sounds bouncing around. Here's a Texas band, the 13th Floor Elevators. Now, this is not the original release. This is a reproduction. Or because it has this stupid, nothing from the 60s would have that stupid Mark of the Beast on it. Yeah, see, this looks just like the record from the 50s. Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers were great. Frankie Lyman. Frankie Lyman, who's who, Michael Jackson and the Jackson 5 originally were trying to be like a new version of the Teenagers, featuring Frankie Lyman. Then it became Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. Just like originally it was the Crickets, then it became Buddy Holly and the Crickets. But of course you know the song Why Do Fools Fall in Love, and I Want You to Be My Girl, ABCs of Love. They were great. He later died of from drugs in the 60s. He, as an adult, he had a hit with the song The Tracks in My Tears. Here's the Vandals. This is kind of a punk rock, punk rock, kind of somewhat surf band from L.A. in the 80s. Oh, here's Richie Valens going back to his junior high school and performing. So it's a live recording. But this is not original release either, and that's how you tell. Richie Valens. Yeah. So it's not real. And the Turtles did a record where they made fun of other bands' style in the 60s. So it's called Turtles Battle of the Bands, and they pretend to be these other bands. These are all the bands that they pretend to be. And they have like a surf song, and they do all the different styles of music that are popular. You know, they just, it's real good. It's from a reissue from Rhino in the 80s. You can, like I said, any of these that, I'm sure you could look up just about any of these on YouTube and hear them. Of course, it's not the same as actually owning them, but at a certain point, you're never going to be able to own everything. I'm starting to realize that and starting to regret trying. But, I have no regrets. This is from the 80s, probably from when I was in high school, I guess, Spinning Pups. It's all the bands that were popular. Stray Cats was the first band I ever saw in concert. Kim Wilde, you know, that did Kim's Kids in America. Kate Bush, I really like Kate Bush. Some people make fun of me for that. Vapors did Turning Japanese. Yeah, it's all these. If you grew up at that time period, this is like a blast from the past. Peter Tosh, I remember him. Remember Talk Talk from MTV. This is the shit, Dexy's Midnight Runners. This is the stuff. I graduated in high school in 1983, and I remember when MTV came along while I was in high school. And yeah, that really changed a lot. This is Jungle Rhythms and Chants, Jungle Beat. What is this record? Okay, it's a mystery. Oh, this. Why do I own this? This is like some kind of satanic shit. I mean, seriously, current 93. I think it's current 93. I think this is given to me. I think this was given to me by a friend that was into this music. Like, it's really good. And I realized later, current, I think 93 is some big number for the Aleister Crowley people that are into the OTO, the Ordo Templi Orientis. That was a great TV show on television about the... There's a rocket scientist, Jack Parsons, that is really responsible for us going to the moon. He was this guy that kind of looked like a movie star. And he was a rocket scientist, and he came up with the idea of jet propulsion and jet propulsion laboratories. Some people say it's called JPL, but it's really Jack Parsons Laboratory. He founded it. But he was really into this Aleister Crowley stuff. And so he had this big, giant house, and he let all these people into his church stay there, and then future science fiction writers like he was into science fiction and pulps, so he let a lot of science fiction type people stay there. L. Ron Hubbard stayed there, and then L. Ron Hubbard stole his Jack Parsons' girlfriend or something or other, and there was bad blood. And so L. Ron Hubbard, before he founded Scientology, was kind of in with that group. Anyway, there was a TV show about him called I don't know. There was a Jack, just type in to Google Jack Parsons TV show. There were two seasons. My wife and I were really into it. It showed how he was kind of seduced into this OTO. And I've known people that were, I'm in the OTO. And I said, oh yeah, that's great. And I didn't really know much about it. But usually they're hipsters, you know. They're the same type people that were in the OTO back then. Kind of people into science fiction and Lovecraft and stuff. But anyway, the last episode of the second season, he opens the door and there's L. Ron Hubbard. It's like, hi, my name is L. Ron Hubbard. And then you think, okay, the next season's really going to expose all this L. Ron Hubbard stuff, but the next season never happened. And you think, well, maybe they, you know, the Church of Scientology has a lot of money. Maybe they persuaded them not to continue on with that show. But anyway, I just can't remember what it was called. It was really good. It was on one of the streaming channels, the Xantes. I don't remember them being great, but I haven't listened to this record since the 80s, so maybe they're great. I don't want to insult you if you're a member of the Xantes. I just don't remember. Here's a Gene Vincent record. It's not old, you know, you can tell it's not old, but it's music's great. The Fuzz Tones, they were a psychedelic garage band from the 80s. I guess they're still around, but they were really into wearing bones and being having a real authentic 60s sound with an organ and everything. And they put out a million records. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Z-Way.
Yeah, and there's little comic book elements, you know. They definitely were influenced by horror comics, too. And they put out a lot of records.
Please welcome me.
Yardbird's greatest hits. What is dust flying around? Can you imagine that it's dusty in the Gratu Orlov building? It's very shocking. Link Ray and the Raymen. You don't know Link Ray? Discover Link Ray. You can do it with YouTube. Just an Elvis Presley record. It's just the greatest hits record that I bought in many decades ago. The Sex Pistols, Flogging a Dead Horse. If you're not into punk rock, the Sex Pistols actually were really good. I mean, they really were. No, seriously. Oh, here's one of my father's records. See what it was. They were before I was born in the early 60s, my family was stationed in France. My dad was in the army. And over there you could buy there's a German brand of stereos called Telefunken. And you could buy it real cheap over there and then have it shipped back to the United States. So my dad bought the stereo and then he started getting all these records for the stereo. And the Telefunken, last time I saw it, well, he lived in France, then they moved to San Antonio. I was born in San Antonio. And then we were there till 69, then we moved to Germany. And I became aware of being a human being, you know, when I was 5, 6, 4, and I remember the stereo and I played records on it. But then that stereo never wound up when we moved to Hampton, Virginia. I don't think it came to Hampton, Virginia. And then we moved to San Antonio. It definitely was not in our house in San Antonio in the 73 through 75. So the thing about getting I guess my dad didn't realize is you buy these foreign stereos and then it's hard to get parts. Maybe cheap to buy it and bring it back to the U.S. and you've got this wonderful sounding stereo, but then people here in the U.S. can't repair it. I'm sure that's what he discovered. But anyway, this is one of his records. I still got all the records. This is I'll Be Seeing You, Joe Stafford. Yeah, my parents were World War II generation. My dad was missed World War II by a couple of years. But I think he was probably in junior high or high school maybe when it ended. So, you know, they were children during the Depression, which is why my dad never usually would buy a big luxury item like a big console stereo. But yeah, he got it cheap over there. That might have been his rationalization. Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys. Great. This is just one of those records from the dollar bin back in the old days. Of course, Cheap Trick was a great band. Yeah. You remember Cheap Trick if you're my age. Oh, my comedy records are over there. I've got to pull this. This needs to go over in that other. This is the Firesign Theater. Now, the Firesign Theater were this group of DJs in LA, I think, and they combined and did comedy skits on the radio, and then they started doing all these record albums. But see, this is William Stout did this, and I brought the magnifying glass in here. Ah, yes, the atomic magnifying glass. You're not supposed to shine this in your eyes, man. 1975. Okay. So, they have a parody of a police drama called Police Street on this record. It's the worst street in town. But anyway, look at all the detail. It's kind of Morse science. Was the They had another record called Everything You Know Is Wrong. Or was it How Can You Be in Two Places at Once with When You're Not Anywhere at All? Something like that. One of those records had a parody. You're hearing the sound of a television playing an old movie. And the movie was High School Madness with about Porgy Tirebiter. And it was basically a parody of Archie comics. But it was really more like... it was more like Henry Aldrich, the old Henry Aldrich radio show, which is also a they made into a comic book. But, and this is, I know about this stuff because I'm a historian, but most people that know who Henry Aldrich is are going to be 20 or more years older than me. But anyway, it was a radio drama that was, and Henry Aldrich was a lot like Archie Andrews, and every episode started with the mother going, Henry Aldrich, and he'd go, coming, mother, and he had kind of a squeaky voice. But anyway, they have this movie about Porgy Tirebiter, and he's like the coolest teenager in town or whatever, I forget what it is, but anyway, he's kind of halfway Henry Aldrich, halfway Archie Andrews. And the but this stuff is very surreal and very bizarre. But I think that must be Porgy Tirebiter. But it looks a little bit like Alfred E. Newman from. But if you look at the art, very influenced by Will Elder, of the early Mad EC comics. So this is a tremendous cover, and you just look at all the details and. If you were at any doubt that it was a pastiche of Mad stuff, Maz, the restaurant there that's shaped like a dinosaur, is in the Mad circus style, lettering style. You could listen to this record on YouTube for free, but then you won't own this cool sleeve. And look at the back. You know, how could you resist buying this record? You know, when I was a kid... When I went into a record store, I would first go to the comedy section and the movie soundtrack section. That's just how I was. And it's still today, when I go into any store, supermarket, I first go to the magazine section. I still am just the same way I was when I was a kid. In fact, if you watched a couple episodes back when I went in that Kroger, I first go to the magazine section. Of course, there's never anything good in magazine sections anymore, but here's Orson Welles' War of the Worlds, but... Of course, this is available on YouTube. Oh, this is great. The Collins Kids. Man, they are so great. Rockabilly style music from the 50s. Their brother and sister. This guy later became a producer and songwriter. And wrote, if you grew up in the 70s, you know the song Delta Dawn. Tanya Tucker, later Helen Reddy covered it. I like the Tanya Tucker song better. Oh man, I love that song. I could listen to that a million times. But he wrote that song. Alright. Collins Kids, look them up. Sophisticated Songs by Nancy Steele. Playgirl. This is a cool record to... See, this record label must have specialized in putting girls on there to sell the stuff. Okay, this is a reissue of the Rocketeens doing Woohoo, which was a great song. And if you have seen Kill Bill, you've seen one of my favorite bands, the Japanese girl band, the 5678s, doing their cover version of that. But I was into that band before Quentin Tarantino by a good 10, 15 years. So. This is a disrespectful record. But it's from RCA Victim instead of Victor. And you see the dog vomiting into the Victrola. Let me tell you something about... I assume you know about the RCA Victor dog. Nipper. He's not supposed to be vomiting into that. Obviously, this is a parody record. But if you ever look at it, I'll tell you a little secret about that. Okay, so it's a Victrola. And it always says, what does it say here? It always says his master's voice, right? It says, he makes me sick. Okay, so you've got a dog, and it's cocking his ear, you know, like dogs, when they try to understand you or hear a familiar voice, they cock their head, right? They say, cock his ear, cock his head. So there's a Victrola, and it says his master's voice, and that's on every RCA Records label, you know, that was their symbol for years. And you think, okay, that's cute. The dog hears his master on the record, and it's like, oh, where's his voice coming from? The original painting was far more poignant. The dog, what you don't see, unless you see the original painting, the dog is sitting on top of a coffin. The owner is in the coffin. The owner is dead. And they've got the Victrola playing the owner's voice, and the dog is... So then it becomes, instead of just being cutesy, it becomes, like, real sad. And so they don't show the coffin. But let me show... Look at this record. Elvis's Greatest Shit. And they've got, of course, National Enquirer snuck a camera into Elvis's funeral and took a picture of him, and that's a that dead person. This is put out by these assholes. What they did is they got Elvis's worst records. 22, count them, dumb songs on one long playing record album. The very best of the very worst. Includes 9 rare previously unreleased recordings. Big fucking deal. Sing along with the king, make a total asshole of yourself. This record is about as funny as a turd in a punch bowl. But what it is, it's like records, songs from his movies. He was forced into that movie career by a deal that his manager set up. And then that kind of just ruined him in the 60s, doing all these silly movies. And that he wasn't taken seriously anymore. This is Music of the Strip by the Cousins. So, the Cousins introduced the burly beat. So this is music, if you're a burlesque stripper, you need this record. And there's a whole bunch of records that are meant for strippers. Okay, what do we got here? The Ramones. Oh, I saw the Crypt Keeper of Castle Hills gave us a little glimpse of his new penthouse condominium apartment, whatever, that he's in San Antonio and Castle Hills, and I saw he had some cool Ramones posters on the wall. But I put a little comment this morning. It's like, give us a full tour. He may not be ready to do that, or he may not want to do that, but I'm eager to see it. End of the Century. This is the one produced by Phil Spector, and Phil Spector pulled a gun on them during the session, telling them, keep going. And he did that to John Lennon also, from what old stories, that he's liked to pull guns on. So when it turned out that someone was shot in his house, this girl that starred in Barbarian movies, it wasn't really that shocking, because we knew that the guy was nuts, first of all. Brilliant producer, but we knew he was nuts, and that he liked to pull guns on people. And it's like, oh shit, why did his legacy have to end that way? You know, couldn't you just been the crazy guy that liked to pull guns? Don't pull the trigger. Because then, every time you hear a Phil Spector song, then, you know, it's tainted by that. This Friday Night Only, from the hate fuck capital city of the world. Anyway, Pussy Galore is a great band, and this is this album. I don't know if this is a Japanese version. It must be, because it's Japanese. That's a nice hint. Shit. These two records seem to be glued together. Why would that happen? What happened here? Damn. Strange. Okay. Well, this is a reissue of this record. So the fact that it got some damage there is not going to be a tragedy. But I don't know why that happened. Yeah, it was stuck to this record. There. Elvis the Hillbilly Cat, which is a... You know, just any way they can repackage the old Elvis songs, they would do it. Here's Johnny Kidd and the Pirates rarities. I think he's a lot more famous over in England, but did Shaking All Over. The Pirates Out of Their Skulls. That looks a little like my old friend Joe Riley that did the Hypnotic Eye. Carl Perkins, original Sun Greatest Hits. This is from Rhino Records. Okay, now, these people are just like us, the Phantom Surfers. I would not be surprised if one of the Phantom Surfers watches this channel or one of your channels, but they're a band from the 90s, 80s, whenever, that the boys with the masked West Coast sound. They're a surf band that wore masks. There's another great one that's same time period called the Mummies. Oh, are they great? And they, they're great. And, they dressed as mummies. The Pandoras, Stop Pretending. This is the band I told you before played so loud that it damaged people's ears. I think she went on to be in a band called the Muffs, and the lead singer, I think she had a brain aneurysm and died in the shower or something horrible. I forgot about Mojo Nixon and Skid Roper. I remember in college really thinking this was funny stuff, really great stuff. I need to listen to him again. I haven't listened to him in many years. This is this looks like a 60s record, but it was another record from 1984. Yeah. Yeah, and what it is, it's a fake soundtrack record. Music from Give Daddy the Knife, Cindy. Original soundtrack album. They're pretending that there was a movie, and this is the music from it. That's kind of a cool... It's kind of a cool concept, right? It's in color. Ooh, this was a scary thing. I went out and bought this record. I was looking... You couldn't find Ricky Nelson records in the 80s, right? So I go out and buy this record, right? It was New Year's Eve, and I bought this record. I went over to Fort Worth and bought it at the, whatever that record store was over there on Camp Bowie. And I go to a New Year's party that night, and so they had the television on because they were waiting for the ball to drop, and it's like, Ricky Nelson, age 42. I was like, what's going on? And he died in a plane crash going to, I guess, perform a New Year's Eve concert. And it was all over the news. And I thought, I bought the record. Then he died within a few hours of me buying it. I thought, did I curse him? What happened? Here's a bootleg Frank Zappa record where they tried to made it look like a Famous Monsters cover. Famous Mothers of Invention. And they got all the monsters they took. Some of these bootleg records can have really cool covers. But, oh, here's Rudy Ray Moore. Eddie Murphy just played him in a movie recently. This is the third Rudy Ray Moore album, The Cockpit, featuring his... famous routine, Petey Wheatstraw, the Devil's Son-in-Law. Later, they made a movie out of Petey Wheatstraw. But yeah, that's Rudy Ray Moore. Okay, what do we got here? Why are these records sticking together? What is going on? I guess, damn, that's the second time this has happened. The milkshakes out of England. And the same guy was also, he had several bands. One was The Mighty Caesars. And this is The Mermaids that did that song Popsicles and Icicles. Here's Little Peggy March. Boy Crazy. You know him, you know her from I Will Follow Him, which is a really great song. Speaking of I Will Follow Him, here's a record of Charles Manson's recordings, because, you know, he thought he was going to be the next big recording artist. And the Beach Boys actually covered a song or two of his with some slight changes. Oh, well, he's not very good. This is a band called the Mad Daddies. And see, mad style lettering. And this is them. And they are a lot like the Cramps. And some people think that this is actually Poison Ivy Rorschach of the Cramps posed here on the cover. But, out of New Jersey. But, yeah, there's some Cramps connection there. Here's Julie London. Now, she was beautiful and had a great singing voice. You know her from the song Cry Me a River. But this is her all the months of the year. She married Jack Webb of Dragnet fame. And, you know, Jack Webb did Dragnet about plainclothes policemen. And then he also did Adam 12 about uniform policemen and patrol car. And then he also made about another show about firemen, about paramedics, called Emergency, which was a big hit in the early 70s. And Julie London, I don't know if she was still married to Jack Webb at the time, but maybe they were still friends, because she plays an important role in the TV show Emergency, which was another Jack Webb show. I'm going to go downstairs and make sure my recording is still doing okay. So, sounds like it's still recording. Okay. Now today at 1, I hope that he's doing his an episode. Mr. Quintron out of New Orleans is gonna. He's been doing for the last 3 weeks a show called, I forget what it's called, but it's got organ music, and I've been really enjoying it. Last week he had all this trouble with buffering, and then he never put the show up. I left it on YouTube, so I was hoping he's not just disgusted and not going to do a fourth episode. Yeah, it's real good. Okay. Rolling Stones, Black and Blue. Nothing to see here. So, it's cool to unfold it. Here's Rolling Stone, Made in the Shade. Rolling Stones. More Hot Rocks, Big Hits and Phased Cookies. else we have here? Best of Ed Ames. Oh, this is the name that I was trying to think of the other day. I was trying to think of this damn stupid poet, Rod McEwen. He wrote Charlie Brown music for one of those Charlie Brown theatrical movies, but I was telling you about this horrible record store that some people have good memories of in Dallas, and then I kind of stopped because I didn't want to like speak ill of the dead. Some people really thought that was just the greatest record store, but the owner of that record store was this sleazy looking guy that you'd bring a record up to him, he'd price it because nothing was priced, and he'd give different prices to you, different people, different prices. But anyway, Rod McEwen was his old boyfriend from many years ago, and maybe they broke up, and then he just came to this CD record store. I don't want to say bad things about it. Why do I have these Rod McEwen records? I have no idea. I don't think I bought them. This was probably from when I listened to The Warm. I think I bought a bunch of records from another teacher I worked with, and these were in them. Just like I have no memories of buying a Mungo Jerry record, which is this is the guy that did that song in the summertime, yeah. He's all right, I guess. And I don't know why I own the music of Jankowski. I don't even know who the fuck he is. Yeah, this is from someone else's collection. I just shoved it in here. Jerry Jeff Walker, yeah, this definitely is from him. He said, I've got all these records in the garage, and he wanted to get rid of them, and so he just sold me his whole collection, and there was some stuff that was more interesting than others, and Stevie Wonder, Elton John. Okay, well, that's that box. But what's underneath this box? This is going to be difficult. Oof. Or will it? Maybe not. Let's see what these records are over here. Here's examples of what my father had in his record collection. Just Arthur Fiedler, nothing fantastic. I got this record in fifth grade, Wacky Winners. It was just a Peter Pan record. And it was all these, songs like Alley Oop and these novelty records, but none of them were by the original artist. But I remember this entertaining me. It entertains 10-year-old. Oh, here's another Rolling Stones record. I'll put this with the Rolling Stones stuff here. This monster high doll that this thing, my wife was kind of into those, and I bought her some. Now they've been absorbed into my stuff. Here's that other Beach Boys record that was a, the one I showed you was a sequel to this one. And it's just 70s reissue stuff, but this record did change my life because my oldest brother had an 8-track of this 2-record set, and he'd play it in his Ford Maverick when he'd drive me around. See, I was like 8 years old, and he was in college. And I would hear this Beach Boys music, and it was just wonderful. It was like a revelation. And he never had good taste in music later on, so I'm thinking it was all influenced from maybe a girl he was dating at the time that had good music musical taste. Because later, he'd be buying shit like Dan Fogelberg. And it doesn't get much worse than Dan Fogelberg. No offense if you're into Dan Fogelberg. Sometimes people in the comic books have strange musical taste, but I'm sure people think I have strange musical taste. I'm sure they do. Let's pull out some good records. Don't worry, I'm still here. Much of Smothers Brothers records, that's cool. Oh, wow. Okay, I found some cool stuff that I can show you. Okay. It's a Japanese record. There's no English writing on it. Yes, there is. 18 hit numbers in 1969. So I don't know who this is. At first I thought it was Twiggy, but I don't think that's Twiggy. This Ventures record is great. Batman theme. All the hits by Bobby Rydell. Volume 2. Dr. Pepper. These are Dr. Pepper jingles with Dick Clark and Donna Lauren, who was the Dr. Pepper girl. And I've got posters of her all around the house. Well, she's like a friend on Facebook. She still records music and still looks good. This is a record that was a hand-me-down from my older brothers. And it's got all this great Mitch Miller and the Sandpipers music from these golden records. And that's scribbled either my older brothers or myself. It's probably me as a little kid. So I've got all these children's records over there, so it needs to go in with them. This record I have not seen on YouTube or ever re-released, Songs About Heroes. and it's featuring the Sandpipers, Terry Gilkison, Wynn Strachey, Mike Stewart, and Mitch Miller in orchestra. But these were all, I guess, originally on little 45s. There's Superman. That's the Superman theme that you've heard. I played it before on here, but when I play it, it causes me to get a letter, an email from YouTube saying that because you played that song, no one in Cuba, North Korea, Iran, or Syria is going to be able to hear. And I think, why are these four countries that have all these problems, why is it they're not allowed to hear the theme to Superman? Or are they going to? So anyway, but it has religious songs, it has the Lone Ranger theme, and they're all great. It has Pecos Bill. This record is really scratched up, so I wish I could get a better quality copy. The religious ones are really good, like this Daniel and the Lion's Den song is great. John Henry, Wyatt Earp theme, Davy Crockett, Yancey Derringer. This is from the 50s when my older brothers were little kids, and it was handed down to me, you know, around 1970, and then I grew up in my childhood listening to the same record. Songs About Heroes. If you ever see this in a record store and you're not interested in it, pick it up and I'll buy it from you. Here's a shrink-wrapped Olivia Newton-John record. And I like Olivia Newton-John. It's, I'd say it's a guilty pleasure, but no, I don't feel guilty about it. So it's not a guilty pleasure. I found this. This is my high school, but from way before I went to the high school, their choir putting out an album. But I remember the alma mater and fight song from the stupid pep rallies they'd force us to go to. So I bought the record. But that, I'm sure the school was a lot better back in the 50s when people listened to good music. And I'm sure they're still, just because they dressed better and listened to better music and had cooler cars, people are probably still the same assholes, let's face it. This is another record from my childhood, The Gingerbread Boy. Here's the golden gospel piano of Jimmy Swaggart. Remember him? He was, put it right behind the Jerry Lee Lewis record. He was related, I think he and Jerry Lee Lewis were cousins. Okay, when the Comedy Channel, Comedy Central first started, it was called the Comedy Channel in the 80s. And it was real cool because in between comedy shows, they would run old cartoons and Scopatones. Scopatones were films that were made for these jukeboxes in the 60s made in France that would play films on a screen and you'd see the singers singing or the band singing, but in the background there'd be all these barely clothed women, kind of like some of these album covers. And some of them were French bands and some were American bands, and they would play Scopatones. I would record them off of the Comedy Channel. And they would play old cartoons that I'd never seen before. And they had a show, like on every day, called The Sweet Life, hosted by Rachel Sweet, who was this, I guess she's comedian and singer. And she was real cute and had kind of a Betty Boop voice. But she did this record at some point, and I bought the record. Anyway, Rachel's sweet. Jackie DeShannon. We wish you a Merry Christmas. Here's a record, Edgar Bergen teaching you how to be a ventriloquist. I'll put that with the children's records. I was a kid, we'd go to the public library here locally, and they would have records that you could check out of old radio shows, and I would bring them home. I'd put my childhood tape recorder with audio cassettes next to the record player, and I'd record the radio shows, and then I'd return the record. Well, they eventually got rid of all their records at big sales they'd have down in the basement. They'd get rid of old books and records and whatever they didn't need anymore and raise money for the library to buy new books. So this is what they look like when you... So I bought one of the records I checked out as a kid, and it's The Adventures of Sam Spade, the complete unedited radio broadcast of June 19th, 1949, CBS Network, sponsored by Wild Root Cream Oil, and The Apple of Eye Caper with Howard Duff. Okay, so this Radiola company put out these record albums in the 70s. There was a big nostalgia craze in the 70s, and there were a lot of records that were put out of old radio shows. So how they would check out a record, they'd check it out in a plastic sleeve like this, right? That's where the card would go. And then in the center, that's where the record would go. And then you have to open it up and pull the record out here. And that kept the records from spilling out when people checked them out and shattering. So this is a little bit of my childhood that I wound up getting. Oh, here's some more Firesign Theater records. This is one of the early ones. The Firesign Theater presents Waiting for the Electrician or Someone Like Him. I remember not liking this record as much as their later stuff. Oh, this is the one that you need to look for. Well, it's the best one. Has a parody of an old radio show like that. Like that Sam Spade radio show. They did a parody of an old radio show called Nick Danger, Third Eye. That's the best introduction. I heard that played on the radio when I was in sixth grade, and I couldn't believe how funny it was. And so I sought the record out. And that one, I'll show you the album that's on. But this is a really good record too. This is called Don't Crush That Dwarf, Hand Me the Pliers. But this is the one that has that High School Madness on it. From Paranoid Pictures, High School Madness. So this was done in 1970, this record. Yeah, Firesign Theater. You know, I'd say they're the closest to capturing an audio Harvey Kurtzman's Mad EC comic book, but that's not true. The closest to capturing the insanity and the coolness and the realistic parody, where if you parody Elvis, you make it sound exactly like the arrangement on the RCA record. The best guy is Stan Freberg. Stan Freberg, yeah, and I know I'm friends with his son on Instagram and Facebook, Donovan Freberg. And Stan Freberg did a lot of the voices in the Warner Brothers cartoons, too. So you probably know him from those as well. Oh, and Beanie and Cecil, the original puppet show that the cartoon's based on, he was into that too. Yeah, but later he did a lot of advertising work, creating funny advertisements. Yeah. This is the book, my mother's funeral. Born September 3rd, 1927. Died July 29th, 2001. This is where people signed, you know, that were there. Okay. Oh, this arm goes to a robot downstairs. I need to go reunite it. There's some, what is this fucking guy? Jack Skellington. My wife bought that. These missiles go to a robot ape. They shoot from a robot ape that's over there that Joe Riley built and painted. And it crawls around and shoots missiles, but yeah, Joe Riley was a great talent. What the fucking hell? Let's go down and check out the recording. And I'll reunite this arm just in case this damn song is... This song's like a song that's going to get me some kind of copyright problem because it's a song that people know. So I'll just head on downstairs again. And this arm has to be united. The robot's like... I can see it. He's right there. It's quite a momentous day. The robot gets reunited with its arm. That should maybe be the title of this episode. Here we go. He's a micronaut. Okay. When I bought this from my friend, it was in this configuration with this penis drill. And this is his other arm. Goes on like so. Now he's complete. The only thing missing is there were two rubber tire treads that went on his legs. And those, I've seen them around. I gotta find them and put them back on there. And now he's pretty much a complete robot. You know, he could have this head too. But this particular I think that's the ideal configuration for this transforming robot. Now let's find a good place for him on the shelf. I had him like pulled aside because I wanted him to have his other arm. Oh, that's so great, right next to this thing from our wedding cake. And this devil girl. Yeah. Okay. Now while we're doing it, while we're down here, let's I wonder how close it is to 1 o'clock. Oh, here's my wife's tablet. Oh, I can show you that movie theater. On here. It's 12:37. It's almost 1 o'clock. Let me check on YouTube and see if... Because usually he goes on... Oh, shit. Usually he goes on about 20 minutes early and does a pre-game show. So... A serious error occurred. To help fix your YouTube app, your settings have been reset. Go to settings to restore them. That doesn't sound good. Hold on. Okay, so Mr. Quintron. Oh, he's on live. Okay. Wait. It says live in 7 days. See? Live in 7 days. Europe. set reminder. 5 waiting. Okay, so he's going to skip today, apparently. But why would it say live? Okay, well, he must be skipping this week. Okay. Let me show you this drive-in theater. There was a video that showed it. Why would they? Oh, here we go. Try to prop it up here. That's the building attached to it. They have an art gallery, and that's the old theater. That's the projection booth. That's looking from the balcony, I imagine. That's the empty space, you know, where I could put my arcade machines, and maybe we could have a small comic convention there. The space next door is an art gallery. This giant, and they have a space there where they also do art lessons. And then there's the stairs that go upstairs to the part that they don't show you, but this part, and and that's the courthouse that's across the street. It's in a town square. Anyway, there's two buildings for sale. The upstairs loft area in that pink building is the question, like, how much would it cost to turn it into a living space? And I guess my friends will find out tomorrow when they go to look at it. I got this set up, the estate sale. I thought it was really cool. It's an antique. I typed this into my phone while I was at the sale. This was hanging in the master bedroom. It's got to be at least 100 years old. And it's a very inspirational religious saying. Ich will juk ein nuvis. I don't remember. You speak German, maybe you can translate it for me. Here's a painting, a self-portrait I did. Yeah. We're here to look at records, so let's stop playing around here. Well, it's a shame that Quintron's not going on today. Okay. Oh, now they're playing Elvis. That's probably going to get me a copyright strike. I better go upstairs. Well, oh, here, remember these records? They're all-time great bloopers from old TV and radio. This is 3 and 4. I used to have tons of these records out. This is volume 1 and 2. And here's 5 and 6. Schaefer was the guy that started all that blooper craze. I better lift this record box correctly because all I need is a fucking hernia or a back problem right now. All right. Okay, more records. Oh, shit, there you are. Jesse Crawford. A lovely way to spend an evening. Okay. This is, R. Crumb's band. He wasn't just an artist, he had a band, because he was really into the old 78 RPM blues records, and so he did. This one is actually made in the 70s, but it's actually 78 RPM, so he's got all his illustrations. It's got My Girl's Pussy and Christopher Columbus. Both are very dirty songs, but they're real songs from back then that were dirty then. And this is on YouTube. I just looked at this up this morning. And this is another band. This one is actually playable on modern phonographs. It's a full album. So he was into that stuff. Very pretty record albums. We dig Pat Dahl. There's a record without a sleeve. The Golden Story, Superman's Mystery Power. Oh, this, I know where this goes. Here's Dick Dale. We saw him play about 10 years ago at the Dallas Museum of Art, and he had his son playing with him, who I think he intended to be his successor. He was training him to be the new king of the surf guitar. And I recorded it. I've got it on tape. That's probably something I should put up on YouTube. Here's The Damned. Phantasmagoria. I remember liking the song Shadow of Love, but yeah, The Damned is good. Bobby Darin's great. Really unfortunate that idiot, what's his face, made that movie about him that didn't look anything like him. What's his name? can't think. Always blank on names. When you see this label, Command Records, they have superb stereo sound, and it's just gonna knock you out. All the sounds coming from all around you. It's anything on Command Records you need to pick up, even if you don't know who it is. They were meant to really show off your hi-fi stereo. Here's another one on Command. Strange Interlude. Lou Davies and his orchestra. Yeah, good stuff. When I saw that his radio show, Mr. Quintron, was going to be on next Sunday, it said April 18th, and I realized, oh, my birthday is real close. My birthday is April 20th. So I guess my birthday is not this Tuesday, but the next Tuesday. This is Ronnie Dawson that was from Dallas. And you know him from Rockin' Bones. And he, Rockin' Bone and Action Pack was another hit. He was really good, and some friends of mine became good friends with him, and I remember going over to their house, and he'd be there playing guitar. It was really a cool thing, but Rockin' Bones, if you're into rock, I mean, Ronnie Dawson, if you're into rockabilly, you know who that is. This is the Trans World Symphony Orchestra. It's Safari, Edmund DeLuca's Safari. So, you know, it's one of these records to really show off your stereo. Lenny D. Now, Martin Denny put out these Exotica records. And it's, you know, the GIs, World War II. Heard all this weird, wild music while they were overseas in the islands, whatever, and when they came home, you know, settled down, got married, then they started, you know, buying these records to kind of remember that cool music they heard in their youth. Now, this lady here, I think her name is Sandy Warner, she's the same girl on all the covers of these Martin Denny records. Some people don't realize that because she looks very different from record to record. Yeah, see, that's the same girl. This is Aphrodisia, the Exotic Sounds of Martin Denny. Yeah, all the hipsters with their tiki bars, you know Martin Denny, and of course, I'm not making fun of people with tiki bars at all. Seriously, I want to have a tiki bar. But this is a really great one. Primitiva, because she kind of reminds me of Nova from Planet of the Apes. I'm pretty sure it's the same girl on every cover. There might be a few that don't have her. Exotic Moog, Martin Denny. Here he's experimenting with Moog, the Moog, and Quiet Village, done with a Moog, is brilliant. Let's look that up on YouTube. Now here's a really good band that you would like if you don't know them, the Dickies. And here is Dawn of the Dickies. Where Did His Eye Go is about Sammy Davis Jr. These are all great songs. Did a cover of Knights in White Satin, you gotta hear that. Attack of the Mole Men, which is about, I think it's about the Mole Men from the movie The Mole Men, not the Mole Men from Fantastic Four. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Although one of the guys in the band is named, he goes by Stan Lee. It's this guy here named himself after Stan Lee. So they're cool people, the Dickies. Here's Stukas over Disneyland. Gotta listen to all styles of music. It's good for you. Here's the Dirty Old Men, Fertilization. Here's Bill Doggett in stereo. Here's some modern Jimmy Dorsey record that I think you'd just buy in up Skaggs Albertsons. Oh, one of the great songs, 6 Days on the Road by Dave Dudley. If you're into trucking songs, that's a great one. Definitely great. The Dwarves, I saw the Dickies live. I've seen the Dwarves live. Dwayne Eddy is great. The Twang's the thing. What else do we have here? Oh, these seem to be in some form of alphabetical order. Astonishing. Here's Barbara Eden, star of the TV series I Dream of Jeannie, for those of you that didn't realize it. Of course, on the other side, this one. Interesting. Electric Frankenstein. The Electrosonic Orchestra. Les and Larry Elgar at Sound of the Times. Okay, here is one of those great bands, the Cramps. Songs the Lord Taught Us. Probably the first, this is a different printing. If you want to introduce yourself to the band, you'd probably want to start with this. Later, they were they were good for a long while, but their later albums are just not up to snuff, in my opinion. This guy wasn't the albums where he's on, because he looks like he's Boris Karloff or something. The albums with him, Brian Gregory, are, in my mind, a little are the ones to get. Okay. Here's the Cramps' Gravest Hits. That might be a good way to start. And then this is their album, Psychedelic Jungle. And that's an outstanding album. This is a live, or a make-believe live record called Smell of Female, which is from the phrase Smell of Female comes from the opening of Faster Pussycat Kill Kill. And they do the theme to Faster Pussycat Kill Kill on this record. And it's real good. This record is great. I think the first exposure I had to the band was this record in the early 80s, Bad Music for Bad People. And their logo is right from Tales from the Crypt. They were comic book collectors and collectors of old rockabilly and garage rock and doo-wop, and they knew the old music, and they would do their own songs, and they do cover versions of old rockabilly songs, and they turn them even crazier, and they would also do pastiches. You know, you take like an obscure surf instrumental song, and then you add words to it, or you combine two songs together, kind of like the Trashmen did with Surfin' Bird. You know, they took two songs by the Rivingtons, combined them, and turned out something great. And they would do that same thing. They would, some of their people put out whole records where they've investigated where are these songs from, and they find all the original songs that they took from, and they put whole albums out of those old songs. This is their song, Bikini Girls with Machine Guns. So, yeah, and then, and they put out these, records, Songs the Cramps Taught Us, and they were, collections of the old songs that they covered. And so that's how, you know, like Ronnie Dawson that did Rockin' Bones, he had a resurgence in his career because the Cramps covered his song Rockin' Bones. And people, you know, that listened to the Cramps thought that they had written it, but then no, they told people in interviews, no, this comes from this guy, Ronnie Dawson. So then all of a sudden he was playing all over Europe and places. This is the theme song, Get Off the Road, from Herschel Gordon Lewis's movie, She Devils on Wheels. And so they covered it. They did a real good cover version. This is much after this. This is their song, Can Your Pussy Do the Dog? And see, you know, all the old posters they've got. I've got this poster here, Adam and Six Eves downstairs. But yeah, they were into all the cool stuff. The lead singer, Lux Interior, passed away, oh, I don't know, 8 years ago or so, and the band just disappeared. Here's a bootleg, Tales from the Cramps, where they have like demo versions that never got released, I think. And this is another version of it, Tales from the Cramps. See, this is a real bootleg. You know, it's a bootleg when they just put a photocopy in there as the sleeve art. There's tons of bootlegs, but now all the bootlegs are just probably easily available on YouTube. See, I'm forgetting everything. I hate these fucking bootlegs that just are black covers like this, and a picture of a pig on the back. That was this one bootleg company did covers like that. No imagination. Some of these, you know, people would record live concerts, and now it's just like the whole thing's changed, where people record live concerts and just put it right up on YouTube, and no one thinks anything of it. But back then, you know, you sneak in a recording device. This is a radio interview with them, and into a venue. It was like here's a bootleg of the Cramps playing CBGBs. If you snuck and recorded a band, that was like the worst thing you could do. But no one makes money from records anymore anyway, because records aren't really the way that yeah. songs we taught the Cramps. So these are original songs that they covered, like The Boss Tweeds, Faster Pussycat Kill Kill, and Sunglasses After Dark by Dwight Pullen, Fat Back by Link Wray, Rockin' Bones, Ronnie Dawson, Tornado by Dale Hawkins, Roy Orbison doing Problem Child, The Ventures doing The Fourth Dimension, Love Me by The Phantom, Rock on the Moon, Jimmy Stewart, not the Jimmy Stewart from It's a Wonderful Life, different Jimmy Stewart, Tear It Up, Johnny Burnett's in the Rock and Roll Trio, Bust Out by the Busters, Jungle Hop, Kip Tyler and the Flips. The original drummer was Miriam Lena, and she was only with him like around 1976, and she left the band because I don't think either she liked them or they liked her or whatever, and she formed Norton Records, and she and her husband put out Kix Magazine, and they put out a lot of great records over the years, but she was really cool, and my friends are friends with her and her husband, who passed away. And here's another one of those bootleg ones, The Cramps After Dark. This is one of my father's records, the Glenn Miller Carnegie Hall concert. You know, they found out in recent years, you know, Glenn Miller was killed during World War II, traveling around. His plane crashed, they just went missing, and now they know what they finally figured out what happened is the bombers that went over and bombed Europe, that came from England, they'd go over and drop bombs on Germany, whatever, and then they'd fly back, and if they had any bombs that they hadn't dropped, they just dropped them in the English Channel before they came back in and landed in England, because they didn't want to land with bombs on board in case there's a spark, and then they blow up when they land after going on this incredibly dangerous mission. You blow yourself up landing when you're back home safe. So they dropped the bombs, but it was a foggy day, and they dropped their bombs. They didn't know that Glenn Miller, the most popular recording artist in the world at the time, was down underneath, and they think that they dropped bombs and onto Glenn Miller, and that that's what happened to him. But, you know, I have Billy Vaughn. I've got radio recordings from here locally when Kennedy was killed, and they say, well, the Glenn Miller Orchestra is going to cancel their show tonight due to the death of President Kennedy. And he's like, well, how is Glenn Miller going to perform? Well, because Glenn Miller's band, even though he was dead, they kept touring around, just like Lynyrd Skynyrd kept touring around, even though the main guys were no longer around after their plane crash. And then just real common stuff like The Doors and Alice Cooper, and I'll just show you stuff that's like interesting, I suppose. There's more Mojo Nixon, Jason and the Scorchers. Those were bands in the 80s. Screaming Jay Hawkins, I saw him live with Reverend Horton Heat as his backup band before Reverend Horton Heat was anybody. In Dallas at the Prophet Bar about 1984 or 85. Got a bunch of Screaming Jay Hawkins records. When he died, they found that he had like 200 or 500 children or something. It was just insane. But as you can see, he lived life in a pretty insane way. But yeah, Screaming Jay Hawkins, great artist. Oh, this is a great band out of Australia, The Scientists. Johnny Rivers. Oh, this is a great record cover. Gene Pitney meets the fair young ladies of Folkland. Ooh, look at this. Some Enchanted Evening. Stanley Black. I love this drawing. Little painting. Got You on My Mind, Gene Shepherd. Here's one of those 70s nostalgic reissues of radio, and Little Orphan Annie was a great radio show. Little Orphan Annie was an adventure comic strip. It was nothing like the musical that people today remember it from. Well, it was in a way, but it was more of a straight adventure strip. But yeah, this is one of the records I remember checking out of the local library when I was a kid. Mary Martin sings Walt Disney favorites. I'm going to put this with the children's records that are over there. Charlie Hamner, Dance Session Number 1. Oh, another good band to investigate is the Revillos. They were somewhat like the B-52s in that they did kind of 60s party music and dressed kind of like space aliens. They were also called the Rosillos. Same band. This band, Red Cross, this is their album, Neurotica, did they were great. They even did a song about Zira from Planet of the Apes. The real 70s Kiss influenced. Learn to Wapadang with the Ranch Hands. I wonder where they got that original photograph. It looks like it's from a Grand Guignol play or something. This record, yeah, this is not a very good cover for it, but you can get this right off YouTube. Just like all of this. It's great. It's Beatles songs with dogs barking and other barnyard animals singing. This guy's not too good. Jimmy Lee Maslin. He's a rockabilly guy from the 70s, but what I know him for is he bought the rights to Blood Feast and 2000 Maniacs, the Herschel Gordon Lewis movies, so that, you know, if anyone needed to release those movies, they had to deal with him there for a while. I don't know if he still owns them. This is cool looking. American Gold, 24 million sellers in a 2-record set. Yeah. All right. Dark Eyes. Tommy Dorsey, Dance Party. A Saturday Night with Pie. I remember this shit from the radio in 1970. If you were a kid in the 70s, remember Mr. Jaws, Dickie Goodman. He did all those cut-in records, you know, the Flying Saucer records were... Because I'm the man on the street, I'm going to interview you about the Flying Saucer. And then it would be, they'd play a little couple of seconds from some hit of the time where they're singing, like in that Mr. Jaws, what was it, Melissa Manchester had that song, One More Time in the 70s, so. And he's in this song, he's interviewing, Mr. Jaws, what do you think of your new hit movie? You know, it's kind of... Mr. Jaws, what did you say to the girl on the beach? And then they'd cut in Melissa Manchester. Wouldn't you give your hand to a friend? Think of me as a friend. You know, it was that kind of thing. Flash Cadillac and the Continental Kids were the band that played at the Sock Hop in American Graffiti, and then later on Happy Days, which started as a copy of American Graffiti. One of Richie Cunningham's old friends from summer camp or something was now in a hot rock and roll band, and none of his friends believed that he knew this guy that was in this band, and that was a pretty good episode. But they were in a episode of Happy Days. The first 2 seasons of Happy Days were good before it started being filmed on a live before a studio audience, maybe shot on film. April Stevens was great. Teach Me Tiger. It was another Billy Strange record. There's a million of these Billy Strange records out there. You remember the Stray Cats. I was always listening to this old music, and all of a sudden in high school, this band, the Stray Cats, comes out, and all of a sudden, for a few brief shining moments, the way I dressed and the way stuff I was into was suddenly cool because people were into rockabilly. But I remember being shocked. God, I thought it was full. I remember being how shocking it was that they had these tattoos. And I remember they had full sleeves, but now looking at it, it's hardly anything. I've seen teachers with more tattoos than that. Now it's like you completely don't even see the skin color. It's complete sleeves. And these, I thought they were more tattooed than that. It's just amazing how much things change because, you know, when I was a little kid, people that had tattoos were either old sailors or Marines or prostitutes or criminals in prison or gang members. And then all of a sudden, this band, pop band, this rockabilly band has tattoos, and it was shocking. Now, almost every teacher has tattoos. It's just so common. Just these kids. Here's more Jimmy Swagger. The Ring of Fire. What shall the end be? Is there really a curse on the Kennedy family? The question is answered in this dynamic message by evangelist Jimmy Swagger. I need to call myself an evangelist. By evangelist and pastor, brought to Orloff. That'll be good. Here's the Tater Tots. Japanese girl band. This was a novelty record from the 60s, the Templeton Twins. No, it's from the 70s. They sang songs, contemporary songs, like they're Rudy Valley or from the 30s, you know, and it's actually kind of cool. This is a great record. This is one of the records my dad bought that was really great. The Sound of Speed. From Tricycle to Rocket, the actual sounds of today's vehicles of transportation in hi-fi recordings and in brilliant musical settings. Yeah, I'm sure you can get this on YouTube too. This album, the 3D Invisibles, you gotta have 3D glasses. If you have 3D glasses somewhere in one of your comic books, put them on and look at this freeze frame, and this will be in 3D. But anyway, this one has, I don't remember it being really great, but it's like the songs, The Monster DJ, The Blob. But this third one, The Master of the Mystic Arts, is about Doctor Strange. March of the Undead, Creature of the Drive-In, Roll Over in Your Grave. I mean, Plan 9 from Outer Space. It's all the song about Leatherface. It's all the stuff we're into. It's kind of like a group of us in college formed a band, but I don't remember them. I remember that song, The Master of the Mystic Arts. Here's another Three Sons record. Here's a Christmas record from the Three Sons. Warm and Tender by the Three Sons. Moving and Grooving by the Three Sons. Now, for the first time, RCA Victor's Action Series in brilliant monaural hi-fi. Okay, here's the Surfing Bird, the Trash Men. Now, this isn't real. There's no UPC code, but just trust me, it's a reissue. It's not the real thing. The original printing would be worth a lot of money, I think. Trash Women. Oh, and the Trogs are great. You know the Trogs from Wild Thing. Katerina Valente. I think she was in movies that we like, wasn't she? I'll have to look her up. Mamie Van Doren, the girl who invented rock and roll. These are the songs she recorded. There's a Velvet Underground record of rarities, unreleased stuff. Awesome Ventures records. This is the favorite band of my friend Gerald that comes over here every Friday. He was all excited. They just put out a documentary about the Ventures. And he bought that on DVD and brought it over. We watched that weekend before last. Ventures must have put out 500 million records. They're bigger than the Beatles in Japan because the thing about Japan is, they're all instrumentals, so they don't have to figure out what they're saying in another language. If you were too young to buy Playboy in the 60s, I guess you could just buy records that had gatefolds of girls in bikinis. Oh, you know the girl I told you that was on the Exotica record covers? All the Martin Denny? They figured, well, she's got a great look. I wonder if she can sing. So they gave her a record contract, Sandy Warner. And, you know, she's good. But and this is Paul Weston, The Sweet and the Swingin'. Some band, I don't remember who it was, some band in the 90s did a remake of this cover. I can't remember who it was. Oh, this is an original. So you can tell it's an original. It just looks original because, it doesn't look brand new, shiny. Last Kiss by J. Frank Wilson and the Cavaliers. Where, oh, where can my baby be? The Lord took her away from me. I pictured that. Well, in the song, it was raining, right? And it was nighttime. And there was blood, the way he described it in the song. But here it looks like they're in a park. And it's just sunny skies. It's all right. You probably don't want to have a cover with a lot of blood on it. George Wright at the Wurlitzer pipe organ. Great Hawaiian melodies. Here's Neil Young when he tried to get on when the Stray Cats were out, and Rockabilly came in for a little bit, and he did a kind of a Rockabilly record. High Noon, Cha Cha Cha. That's a great album cover. Then here's something I got in high school. It's a box set of Sun records. Okay, well, that's two crates of records that you've seen. When I lift heavy things, I speak in tongues. You'll have to. Okay, so we're gonna look at the records over here. I'm going to have to reposition the light. So I could put it here. What's in this box here? Let me go down and make sure my recording's still going. to investigate. The door to the restroom was open, and it's never open, so I figure maybe it was halfway pushed closed and a cat had gotten in there. Okay, so. Alright, so I think we're good with the recording. Oh, this is Quincy Jones. I knew. Hopefully that won't get me a damn copyright deal. Let's see. Alright. We can look at some more records. I think we have more space on this phone to fit in. I gotta move some stuff though. Old photographs of my mom's family. I gotta show some of these. Some of them are messed up from a flood that happened at my grandfather's river house in the 60s. There's some boxes that might have cool things in them. Maybe, maybe not. Okay. Well, this isn't as hard as I thought it was going to be. Yeah, I think this is doable. We'll move this. How hot is this going to be? I guess it's not that hot. It's a little hot. I'll move it over here. Alright. There's always Count Chocula boxes in the way when you need to get around here on the 7th floor of Gratu Orloff International of Trade. Poster here. I was telling you about this maybe yesterday or 2 days ago. That was the poster hanging on my wall in San Antonio in 1974. It's really big. So my oldest brother bought that for me. But yeah, it's cool. I was really into to Young Frankenstein. If I could find out what theater played Young Frankenstein in the north part of San Antonio in 1974, then whatever, it was kind of a weird little mall, not a big one, then I would know where they had this comic, the guy that set up boxes of comic books and sold them. Not that it really matters, because it's not like he's still there. He was some kid that was in high school, probably college, in 1974, like I'm expecting I could go there now and he'd still be selling the Silver Surfer number one for $1.50. Yeah, he's probably still there. He just hasn't been able to find someone that would buy it for him. Wheaties, Breakfast of Champions. Okay, what is this garbage? Someone gave me this. It's like a press kit for Mr. T and the T-Force. It's, oh wow, look at this. Inside, there's a copy. Neil Adams, Pete Stone. It's 9,664 of 10,000. Oh, it's autographed by Mr. T. Wow. This is a promotional, but is it autographed by Neil Adams? I don't know. That's cool. I didn't even know that was autographed by Mr. T. I don't know who gave me that. Issue of Cinefex. Let's move this over here, too. Oh, ha! If you go back to Gratu Orloff's episode number one, my very first episode I ever put on YouTube, I filmed it here in this room, and I was showing off some of my artwork from... No, this is my brother's artwork. I was showing off some of my artwork from first and second grade. Yeah, this isn't mine. But it was in an envelope like this. Let me put this aside. That's my brother that hasn't communicated with me in a couple of years. Which is really sad. Because I don't like that. My wife had just had some pretty serious surgery, and she knew that my brother was very religious and thought she'd call him up because he was very nice to her and her, you know, when we met him briefly and when she met him briefly and and also, you know, he would be very nice to her on the phone, and so she was kind of... She just had the surgery, so she thought she'd call him up, and he'd offer some inspirational wisdom. But he apparently thought when she left a message that she just had surgery, I guess he interpreted that we were calling asking for money or something because of the surgery, which is not what was happening. And then he just sent some message, "Don't call me again. I have enough trouble with my own family," or something. Wait a second, we are your own family. I guess he was talking about another part of the family, but... So, I haven't called him. And she was saying, "Well, I think he was just talking about me, so we'll know if he's talking to you, he's talking to me too, because we're married. When you're married, you kind of become like one." So, that was not a fun thing. But I'm not going to throw away his artwork. Maybe someday. My oldest brother passed away, and my middle brother is... odd, and doesn't want to talk right now, so maybe that will change. So where can I mount my phone? Oh, I was telling you about this the other day when I showed you the wacky packages, how I made my own product. At a garage sale, I saw, it's a bottle of Tang. And someone had a bunch of, I don't remember what they stored in it. So I took the wacky package, blew it up, and put it where the Tang label would have been. And then I put this head I had, I just stuck it in there like it's bottled. But I think it's really cool. I used to have it down in the kitchen on top of the refrigerator. But I moved it up here because I was using it as a sponsor back a while back. I would always have a sponsor for the Gratu Orloff show. I don't know. That joke was funny for a little while. As if anyone would sponsor a show that has 224 subscribers. Someday, maybe Gratu will make it big. But I'm not holding my breath because I'm not into... slabbing comics or talking about here's what I got today at the amazing comic. You know, I don't have any money to be buying things. And damn, I wish I've got one issue of the three issues of the Galactus trilogy. I wish I had the other two. I've got the middle one, you know, the one that everyone loves the cover the most. And I wish I had the Fantastic Four annual number one. Here's some things I made just to put into CD jewel cases. Look at this. I printed them the right size to fit into jewel cases. So, I need to do that. These are just in a box here. I need to start using them. Oh, I love this Bela Lugosi and Vampyra. Oops, I dropped one. Oh, Leslie Gore. And then this is one where you just write from Sony. This sticker used to be everywhere in the 60s. I have an old Red Wagon. And on the back, like two tail lights or two little miniature stickers of this image. But they're barely, you can barely see them anymore because that wagon was left outside in the porch for a good 20 years. Hello, incredible Dr. Orloff. Thanks for stopping by. Believe it or not. Oh, that's Comic Crypt Keeper of Castle Hill sending me a message because probably I commented on his video this morning to give us a tour of his place. Hopefully that's all I could read because it popped up. Hopefully it's about to be, believe it or not, I just filmed one. I hope that's what it's going to say. Oh, what wonderful music. These will look great in CD jewel cases, don't you think? When this camera dies, I wonder if I have much of an electrical charge. I need to go to Taco Bell and get something to eat. I'm about to pass out here. Oh, I love this image. I don't think the last couple of videos I put up have been quite as popular. I've been showing comics as much, and I've been taking you with me to the supermarket and stuff. There are people that watch all the way through the end, which is cool. Ooh, this is good for a Christmas one, Bernie Dexter. She looks a lot like Betty Page. One of my earliest crushes. Leslie Gore. Oh, I was just talking about Jack Webb. Oh, here's the Scopatones I was talking about. The ad for the Scopatone machine. You should relax, rather. The movie way, the drive-in way. I could do so much if I had a theater. So much. I mean, look at everything around here. It would be perfect for a movie theater. I mean, are you kidding me? That's what I was... If only that's not too fucked up tomorrow when we see the images of... I know they replaced the roofs in both buildings, and they're new and everything, but, I don't know. But, yeah, like Captain Strangelove commented, because there's probably going to be 60,000 to 80,000 to turn a space that's 40 to 6 by 60 feet into a living space. With a kitchen and a few restrooms. And I think Captain Strangelove has an apartment building or rental property and knows about that kind of stuff. So yeah, I was hoping people that knew more than me would comment. And that's great that I've got this network of friends on through YouTube that can help.
Yikes!
Except they can't help when I spill shit everywhere. Oh man, fuck shit, piss. What the fucking hell is that? I've got to I'm gonna put some new videos up with some of my old home movies, because I see one here of when Pete the Cat was the brand new cat in the house. It was a little tiny kitten. He came on a cold winter morning and just walked in the door and said, "Hey, this is my home now." And so I've got some video of that, and let me put that up. Okay, so back to figuring out how to film this. Yeah, but what will hold it up? Oh, maybe this autograph hound will hold up this camera. In place. Phone camera, also known as a telephone. Oh, is it gonna work? I can't believe it. I can't believe it. It's gonna work. Oh my god. I got stuff everywhere. This is a That was not good. Remember the when the gray man first saw a video that I shot, he just couldn't believe how many times the camera was dropped in one episode. It's like, that's one of my trademarks. This is a stuffed animal that was handed down to me from my oldest brothers. This is from the 50s, probably early 50s. It was a horse. It's lost its mane. Now it's just kind of this weird Martian looking, like something from Barsoom. It has sentimental value to me, and I guess to someone in heaven. Okay, let's see what's in this incredible box of joy. Okay, here we've got children's records. Puff the Magic Dragon on Happy Time Records. Happy Time. And here's the Witch Doctor. But it's not the Dave Seville record. It's someone must do a cover. This is from Doc's Records. They just write on the sleeve the condition. It might wipe off. Very good-ish. Very good minus. And they go in the back. Get all these. I don't think this... Maybe that lighting's not too good. Maybe I put it too far away. I don't know. Oh, that's okay, I guess. Look at all the cool cartoon art there. Sing along with Chipper and his playmates. Obviously, it's a Chipmunks knockoff. I guess here I could put in that Mary Martin record that I said I need to put it over there with the children's records. Well, here, let me do that. Walt Disney's Fun with Music. Favorite Disney songs. Here's a record that was handed down from my older brothers, I guess from my dad. Jack and the Beanstalk and Rumpelstiltskin, presented by Let's Pretend. Let's Pretend, I think, was an old radio show. 42 Mother Goose Songs by Alec Templeton. Simon Says Records, a treasury of fairy tales. Now here, I'm tempted. I have so many Christmas records, I feel like I should take all the Christmas records and separate them like I've been doing with the Christmas comics. I'm thinking I ought to do that. In fact, I'm going to do that. There were a few Christmas records we just saw over there. I need to go back and get those. Grimm's Fairy Tales. Walt Disney, The Further Adventures of Jiminy Cricket. Conduct Your Own Orchestra, baton included. Do you know Kolchak the Night Stalker, the guy that ran the morgue, was the voice of Winnie the Pooh. He was also Jack the Ripper on Star Trek, right? Remember at the end, he's like gone insane or drunk, I can't remember, and he's going, die, die, everybody die! Which is, cartoons in stereo. Yeah. The Peels, starring Juanita Banana. You can get the coolest stuff at Doc's Records in Fort Worth. Quick Draw McGraw. And I need to get to all my superhero records. They're here somewhere. Then that would actually be comic book related. The Enchanted Key to Mother Gooseland. I got tons of children's records. Isn't there people on YouTube that have all children's records? You can get a lot of the golden records on there. And there's a guy named Boy John. I think it's all run together as one word, Boy John. He has tons of these children's records. Oh, this is The Official Adventures of Flash Gordon. Let me get that lighting a little better. Just a moment. Those lights are almost indestructible, man, because how did the light... Jesus Christ. Somehow that fluorescent bulb never breaks. Just... I hope my wife doesn't watch this episode. That's her light I dropped, but it's still working fine. So look at this. Looks like I made the light worse. Damn it, I'm starving. Isn't that a great cover? Of course it is. Dean Martin's great, of course. Anyway, this label, Leo Records, put out from MGM, it's their children's wing, put out these great records that are like very high quality. They're like listening to an old radio show. And they even brought in Buster Crabbe to be Flash Gordon, I guess for the last time on this record. I gotta reposition that light, sorry guys. They used to sell that in the back of Famous Monsters. But the one that I got as a little kid that was amazing, and it was the first time I really heard surf music, was this. The Official Adventures of Aquaman, Green Lantern, and the Flash. This is a great record, and you can listen to it on YouTube. It's the Silver Age Aquaman origin, but the Flash one is Barry Allen reading a comic book, and then it's the whole story is the Golden Age Flash's origin, acted out word for word from the comic. And then the Green Lantern is the Golden Age Green Lantern, even though they show the Silver Age one on the cover. They use great music in this. There's a song I play all the time on this channel, Billy Muir's Supersonic Guitars, doing a song called Tiger Guitar, or Tiger Guitars. Look up that song. It was used as the theme to Aquaman, because it has kind of a Batman kind of vibe. But this record I got as a kid, and then I got another copy at a Half-Price Books, and I've never seen it any other time in my life. Also from Leo Records. They also did this Prince Valiant record. Gotta get this stuff. And there's, I don't know if they're with these, but there's also a Batman, two Batman ones that they put up. Okay. Okay, I thought maybe this record didn't have the record in it, because I have this, it's a Superman record, but the, remember I pulled this record that didn't have a jacket from over there? Where is it? Here it is. So what Superman record is this? Golden Storyteller. Oh, this is actually the Superman record from the Leo the Lion, I think, yeah. Origin of Superman, The True Story, History of Clark Kent. It's just somehow I don't have the sleeve, I guess. This is Children's Treasury of Superman Musical Stories. It's just kind of silly songs about Superman. This is a 70s Superman record that has episodes from the radio show. Now you can hear every episode of this radio series on YouTube. Oh, here. This is the Golden Records read-along, and you get the comic book with the record. The comic book is in Mylar in the other room. I have two copies of this. It looks a lot like the original, but it doesn't have the price on it, and the ads aren't in there. But it feels like you're holding a comic from that time period, because this is a record from about 1966, so the comic has some age to it, so it doesn't look like a freshly printed comic. It looks like it's a Silver Age comic, and it has value, but of course not the value of the original. I love this image of the thing there. The problem is, unlike those Leo the Lion records, which had great acting, this is even worse than the record. Listening to it, the voices don't sound like Thor isn't very good, and the voices aren't very good. It's just, it's real cheesy. They also did a Spider-Man number one, and they did the Fantastic Four, and the Journey into Mystery, first Journey into Mystery with Thor, which Silver Age Dave bought that original Journey into Mystery, and then he also had the record album, and I think he said he didn't have a working turntable handy, and I said, go on YouTube, you can listen to it, but I said, you'll regret it, because it's not very good. Here's some other records from this isn't from my childhood, Don Quixote, but this Tailspinners for Children, they're well acted. They're classic stories, and they're cool. Oh, here's another one from, this is from my childhood, though. It's another one of those Leo records, and it's Journey to the Center of the Earth, but it's really well acted. And look at that wonderful illustration that looks like it's off the cover of a Gold Key comic. But they also do The Time Machine, The First Men in the Moon, and War of the Worlds as audio plays. It's like old radio shows, and they're really well done. So yeah, this is another good one. I wonder if this one is available on YouTube. I've never looked for it. Let me put it right after Prince Valiant here. Here's a Flintstones record. This is a great album cover. The Man from Flintstone. This was The Man Called Flintstone. This was a theatrical movie made to be like James Bond or Man from U.N.C.L.E. Okay, this, a record from when I was a little kid, because I love trains, was this record. And I still have the record, but I didn't have the sleeve. And then I found this record somewhere, and it has the record and the sleeve. But it was, I remember the Happy Train, but this one, it's not my childhood copy. It's someone named Shelley Complin's childhood copy. This record is on YouTube, and it's fantastic. This is one I inherited from my older brothers. This is one that my dad got, you know, to go with his stereo. It's called Adventures in Sound and Space. Colonel Frank Eckhart and cast. Blast off, free fall. It's like going to the moon, and it's great. It's got music and sound effects. Here's Dr. Seuss. Sing Along with Breezy. More Adventures of Little Orly. And Sorry and Stong, told by Uncle Lumpy, with Fred Waring and the Pennsylvanians. Now, they were a big band. This is cool. The Mighty Hercules. Remember that cartoon? This is my childhood copy of this great Casper record. Now, I took it to kindergarten for show and tell, and we played the record. But I had my mother write on the back of it when I took it to school, because I guess I was troubled by the fact, I mean, it's obvious that Casper's voice is a girl's voice, and in the cartoons too, you know, just like Bart Simpson is a woman's voice, and they always do that in cartoons usually. They didn't do it in the Charlie Brown specials, they used real kids, but then they would grow up a little bit, and the next time, a couple years later, you want to do another Charlie Brown special, well, you got to get a new Charlie Brown, new Linus, because their voices have changed. So if you've got a character that's a little boy and you're going to make cartoons over a long span of time, get a woman to do the little boy's voice, and then their voice doesn't change. So that's why Bart Simpson's that way, whatever. I think Nancy Cartwright or something does her his voice. But anyway, Casper had a girl's voice, and I could tell that. So I have it, my mom's writing here. It says, whenever you hear the girl, it is Wendy. There is another girl's voice in there, except it is Casper's. The loud noise is the Ghostland special. And then I put, that's Wendy singing. Ghostland special is a ghost train in it. This is just a great record and a great album cover. And it's out on CD and now and all that. And you can listen to it on YouTube. Here's a... This is not the radio show. This is adaptations from Wonderland Records. And this is 1979. So this was put out with anticipation that the movie was going to be a huge hit. And it was a great movie, but it was not a huge hit. TV Terry Tunes, Cartoon Time. I love Terry Tunes. Love them, love them, love them. Oh, here's the, these are also Leo. These are real good. This is Batman and Robin, The Official Adventures of Batman and Robin. And then this was the sequel. And the thing about these is the stories are word for word from the comics, so you can read right along with the comics. Let me put these closer to the other Leo records. Part of what I'm doing is getting things more organized. Music for Batman and Robin.
Big Brother Sir Leslie Fabio III. Aquarius. Solemnly mine.
And they've got something written by Commissioner Gordon on the back. There are, for years I collected versions of the Batman theme. There are so many Batman records that were put out. It was a huge cottage industry. And this is the sensational guitars of Dan and Dale. I put together a whole CD of Batman themes once, and